Greetings, Unitarians. It's your boy, Griswold, and today we're going to learn how to make custom shaders in Unity using Shaderforge. At its simplest, a shader is a piece of code that dictates the color of any pixel on our screen. Unity uses a language called HLSL for programming shaders, and I'll let you in on a little secret. I don't understand it. Shaderforge is a plugin for Unity that lets us use a visual programming paradigm as opposed to typing shader code by hand. Unity's default shader is very powerful, but writing custom shaders allows us to create interesting, non-realistic lighting effects, making for a more unique visual style. We'll start with the basics of diffuse lighting, then move to tune style shaders, learn about this halftone effect, and wrap up with a special shading technique called matcap. Let's make our first shader. We're gonna right-click in the project window and go to Create Shader Unlit Shader. I'm gonna call it Custom Lighting. And we're gonna make a blank scene, add some geometry to it. I'm gonna need to make a material that uses our new shader. So if I right-click on the shader and go to Create Material, I'll automatically get a material with that shader. I'm going to apply it to our geometry, and then we're going to open the shader in Shaderforge. So if we click on the shader and go to replace with Shaderforge shader, we will get a blank shader, and the Shaderforge window will open. And right now we only have the main node. So what we want to do first is go to lighting on the left and change the light mode from Blin Fong to Unlit Custom. And you'll notice that some of the inlets on our main node have been disabled. And that's because for our custom lighting shaders, we're only going to be working with the emission channel, as that will let us bypass Unity's default lighting pipeline and let us dictate the exact color of any given surface. So how do we make the shader react to light? The first thing we're going to have to do is use a light direction node. And we can add nodes in Shaderforge in one of two ways. The first is right-clicking the canvas and selecting from these drop-downs. Or better yet, we can hold down any key to see a list of nodes that begin with that letter. So if I hold L and scroll to light direction, we have a node that tells us the direction our light is pointing. And if I hold N and go to normal direction, we get another node that tells us which direction our surface is pointing. Now, in order to calculate a brightness value between these two vectors, we're going to use an operation known as the dot product. Now, you can think of the dot product as a measure of absorption. If two vectors point in the same direction, the dot product will be greater, and as the vectors become perpendicular, the dot product approaches zero. So, if the light direction points in the same direction as our normal direction, we'll have a bright surface. And if the light grazes the normal direction, if they're perpendicular, the brightness value will be zero. Now, if we connect this to our emission channel and rotate our light, we'll see we have a basic shader that gives us diffuse lighting. Now, for our tune shader, we want to replace this smooth gradation in color with a hard step. And to do that, we're going to use a step node. Now, the step node compares two values and returns 1 if A is less than B and 0 if B is less than A. We're going to connect our diffuse term to the B inlet and then add a constant value of 0.5, connect that to the A inlet, and connect the output of the step node to the emission channel. So, now, we've gone from smooth diffuse lighting to two-tone shading. If we change this threshold value, we can dictate the point at which the light switches from bright to dark. Now, in order to get more fine-grained control over these colors and the position of these bands, we can use something known as a gradient ramp. A gradient ramp is a pre-baked texture that dictates the width and color of each band from left to right. If we go back to Shaderforge and drop down a Texture 2D node, you'll notice we get a new green node that we'll call Ramp. Now, if a node is green, that means it will expose a property in the Material Inspector. We're going to need to connect this ramp to a channel before it shows up, so we'll put it straight into the emission. And our shader will turn white, and that's because we haven't selected a ramp yet. You'll notice we have a new field for a texture. So if I go to this three-step grayscale ramp, we'll notice that the texture has been applied to our geometry, but not in the way that we want. And that's because by default, the Texture 2D node is going to use the UV map that's baked into our geometry. Now, a UV map dictates how a two-dimensional image should be mapped onto a 3D geometry. We want to use our diffuse lighting value to dictate the point at which to sample our gradient from left to right. Dark pixels should be sampled at the leftmost point, and as pixels get brighter, the sampling point should move to the right. We can try passing the result of our dot product into the UV inlet, but this will be disabled as the UV requires a two-dimensional property, and our dot product returns a one-dimensional value. The append node lets us create a multi-dimensional vector from one-dimensional components. I'm going to connect our diffuse term to the R or X component of the append node, which lets us move from left to right as the diffuse value increases. And I'm going to connect a constant value of 0 to the Y component, as we don't care where the gradient is sampled vertically, it's the same from the top to bottom. We'll notice we can connect the result of the append node to the UV inlet now. And there, we have Toon Shading with a custom gradient ramp that responds to our light direction. We can use a ramp that has colors baked in for a little more style. And to wrap up our Toon Shader, we're going to want to add outlines. Shaderforge makes this really simple for us. We're just going to need two properties. One for the outline width. We'll set that to a default of something small like 0.05. And another for the outline color. If we connect these to their respective ports, we'll expose two new properties in our material inspector, one for outline width and another for color. Now, try to stay away from black outlines when using Toon Shaders, and for a touch of extra class, go with the darkest shade in your gradient ramp. Now, let's move to our halftone shader. Halftone is a technique used in printing to simulate gradation in color by modulating the density of a two-tone pattern. If we rewind to our step-based shader, we'll remember that we're using a constant value to dictate the threshold. What if we wanted to use a pattern instead? We can drop in a new texture 2D node called pattern, and pass that into the step node instead of our constant value. You'll notice I'm only using the R component of our pattern, as we'll be using grayscale patterns. So in these images, the R, G, and B channels will all be identical. If we pipe the result of this step node into the emission channel again, we will have black because we have yet to set a pattern. We'll go with this dot. And at first this won't look like much, but that's because we need to increase the tiling value of our pattern. Now, you'll notice this is wrapping around our geometry in a strange way, and that's because, again, we're using the default UV map baked into the geometry. What we want is for our texture to be applied in screen space so that it moves with the camera like a 2D overlay. To do that, we can use a screen position node, which gives us a UV coordinate indicating the two-dimensional position of any pixel on our screen. If we pipe that into the UV inlet of our pattern node, we'll see that the texture moves with the camera. And if we change the screen position to tiled mode, the UV coordinates will be applied with a square aspect ratio. There we have the basics of our halftone shader. Now, let's say we want to be able to control the two colors used in this halftone pattern. We can use a lerp node to blend between two colors based on our new thresholded diffuse value. I'm going to create two color properties for dark and light. Pipe those into the A and B inlets of our lerp node, and then pass the result of our step operation to T. And what lerp is going to do is move from A to B as T moves from 0 to 1. If we pipe the result of that into our emission channel, we'll get gray, and that's because these two values are the same right now. But if we select two different colors, we'll notice we have control over the light and dark components respectively. Now, there's one more thing about this shader that's bothering me, and that's the fact that this pattern doesn't grow or shrink based on the apparent scale of our object. So if we're really far away, we're going to lose shading detail on the surface. Shaderforge provides us with a depth node that reports the distance of any given pixel from the camera. If we multiply our screen position UVs by this depth value, and instead use that as the UV input for our pattern, we'll notice that the pattern shrinks and grows as the camera gets further and closer to the object. So for our last shader, we're going to use a technique that I'm particularly fond of called matcap. Matcap stands for material capture, and matcap shaders give us really fine-grained control over the way our surfaces are rendered. We can use an external 3D renderer to render these images of spheres, which contain information about complex lighting data that we wouldn't necessarily be able to recreate in real time. We then use these spheres as a lookup table to determine the color of any given normal direction. So let's go back to our shader, and I'm actually just going to go ahead and nuke the whole thing. So the first thing we're going to do is drop down a texture 2D node, and that's where we'll place our matcap texture. Now if we connect that to the emission channel and drop in one of our matcap textures, we'll see that the texture has been applied to the geometry, but again, not in the way that we want. So we need to determine a new UV point based on the normal direction of this surface. First, we'll need a normal direction node. And we can try connecting that to the UV, but no dice, because that's a three-dimensional vector and we need a 2D vector. We can use the component mask node to strip a vector of its components. So here we're going from a three-dimensional vector to a two-dimensional vector. And we can pipe that into our UV. And again, not quite what we want. And that's because right now these normals are in world space as opposed to view space. We can use a transform node to convert this normal direction from absolute world space to view space. And if we pipe that into our component mask, we'll notice that the texture is starting to move with the camera, but it seems to be sampling pixels from our matcap texture that we don't care about. That's because this normal direction will be in a range of -1 to 1, and we can only sample our texture from 0 to 1. So we can use a remap simple node to convert the range from -1 to 1 to 0 to 1, and pass that into our component mask node. There, we have our matcap shader. Now, for our last step, let's enable bump maps on this shader. A bump map is a two-dimensional image applied to the surface of three-dimensional geometry to make it appear more detailed than it actually is, an essential technique in computer graphics for decades. Shaderforge makes it really easy to add bump maps to our shaders. We'll use a texture 2D node, call it bump, select this normal map option, and pass that into our normal channel. Now we have a new texture field that we can pass a normal map into, but you'll notice that nothing's changed, and that's because we're not using perturbed normals. Now, by default, the normal direction node will only give us the surface direction as dictated by the geometry, but if we want the normal direction node to be influenced by our bump map, we need to select this option. There, we've got a really interesting sort of rippled glass effect. Now, you can find a lot of great matcap textures online. I'm personally fond of this texture from Dragon Ball Z, which has all these great non-photoreal lighting effects. I just grabbed the image off Google Image Search and used Photoshop to get rid of the star in the middle. We can also use matcap to make all sorts of photoreal lighting effects as well. Here's modeling clay, skin with subsurface scattering, or rough metal. So that about does it for today's Shaderforge tutorial. For now, I'll leave you with this shiny blue elephant and bid you adieu. Thanks for watching, and keep on shading.